Yeah, good afternoon, everyone. I again welcome all the module coordinators and course participants in the second lecture under this series on GNSS and GPS as a module under 36th outreach program and as such the 38th outreach program on GNSS and GIS. So we will have a bit revision on yesterday's lecture, followed by today's topic on GPS receivers, processing methods, errors and accuracy. So yesterday we have seen that we are getting position, velocity and time from GNSS receivers, and the technical advantage with this is that it has a common reference frame all over the globe. So we are using WG34 datum for the use of GPS, and if we have to understand the GNSS system, then we break it into three segments where we have a space segment, user segment and control segment, which we have discussed yesterday, and we have seen the role of the monitoring and control stations also. The command of GPS is with the US Air Force. Then the GPS works in a ECEF, that is the Earth-centric, Earth-fixed coordinate system, where the origin is at the center of the Earth. From there, we have all the measurements, which after projection we convert to geographic latitude or UTM projection, and we get the latitude, longitude, or the northing, easting, and height of the point in that system, in that particular projection system, with respect to the particular datums. And in the Navistar GPS system, we have 6 orbital planes, each having minimum 4 satellites within inclination, and the orbit has an inclination of 55 degree to the equator. So minimum 24 satellites are there, and currently we have around 30 to 32 satellites at any point of time. So there is a large amount of redundancy in the Navistar GPS system now. Then very importantly, we have discussed the structure of signals yesterday, that we have two carrier waves, L1 and L2 at 1575 and 1227 megahertz, on which we are modulating two type of codes. One is the course acquisition code, CA code, which is only 1023 bit code. It is also known as the gold code. And then we have a P code, which is modulated on both L1 and L2. When the same code is put on two different frequencies, it helps us to remove ionospheric error. We are able to control the ionospheric error to a large extent. The fundamental frequency considered in this whole system is that of the P code, which also is known as Y code after the encryption. And P code is for US military. It is for the authorized users only. Most of our systems, which are like handled GPS, they are working on the CA code. Whereas the differential GPS systems can be single frequency or dual frequency, which we have discussed yesterday, and again today we will discuss that in more detail. They with the help of the L1 and L2 wavelengths, and with the help of the phase solution, are able to give us accuracy of the orders of millimeter to centimeters. Besides the L1 and L2 wavelength, we have a 50 bit per second satellite message also, wherein we get the chart of all the GPS satellites, which is called almanac, and ephemeris data. Ephemeris is the, we can say it is the, these are the coordinates or the positioning coordinates for the GPS satellites at any point of time in their respective orbits. Then we discussed the GNSS. So I have told you yesterday that initially we used to have a separate receiver for Navistar GPS and a separate receiver for the GLONASS. So, but after the understanding between the US and the Russia, they have come to an agreement and the codes has been shared. Thereafter, 2006 onwards, we started getting single equipment which can receive both the signals from the Navistar GPS as well as the GLONASS from Russia. So same system. So now the minimum requirement, as we discussed, is four signals from four satellites to resolve the four unknown parameters, that is the X, Y, Z and B, where X is the longitude, Y is the latitude, Z is the height above the datum, and B is the clock bias. Clock bias is the parameter which resolves the synchronization problem between the quartz clock and the atomic clock on the satellite. Quartz clock on the receiver and atomic clock on the satellite. So thereafter, we constituted the term called GNSS, Global Navigation Satellite System, wherein we are considering more than one system. So it is also known as a system of systems or constellation of constellations. So one constellation is that of the Navistar GPS, another constellation is that of the GLONASS. And in the current scenario, because BDO from China has also come up and Galileo from Europe is also building at a fast rate. So current GNSS receivers can receive signals from all of these. Additionally, there are satellite-based augmentation systems which are placed so that we can get real-time high accuracy for various applications such as landing and taking off of aircrafts. The satellite-based augmentation systems we will discuss tomorrow, wherein we have a dedicated session for that. So all of these combined together are nowadays considered under the GNSS terminology. So earlier we used to have IGS stations, International Geodetic Stations. Later they were named International GPS Stations. And once the GNSS came into picture, IGS, now we refer as International GNSS Stations. So these are the stations spread over the globe where we have satellite-based navigation systems like GPS, Navistar GPS, GLONASS, or GNSS are working 24 hours, 365 days, and these stations are being used for making the reference for entire Earth, wherein we can study the plate tectonics and other any other phenomena which is taking place on Earth. So combinedly, all together is now termed as the Global Navigation Satellite System. It includes the satellite-based augmentation systems also like VAS, SBAS, IGNOS, MSAS, GAGAN, which we will be covering tomorrow in detail. Then I have shown you this comparative table also, wherein the GPS has about 30 satellites in the constellation, GLONASS has 24, and Galileo has planned about 30 satellites, BDO has around 35. And then we regional systems we are not covering currently. We will have separate session on regional systems also, like IRNSS and QZSS. Now this global systems which are used for satellite navigation, they are providing certain services for the civilians and for the defense. So now Navistar GPS is providing two type of services. One is the standard positioning service, which I have told yesterday. This is based on the course acquisition code, and it can give us an accuracy of the order of 10 to 20 meters in general, and sometimes it can give better accuracies if the DOP value, that is the dilation of precision value, is good. Then there is the precise positioning system service. Precise positioning service, that is for the restricted use by the licensed authorities. These are primarily for the defense purposes, wherein they are using the precise code. So CA code is being used for standard positioning service, and P code is used for the precise positioning service. A parallel of this is being maintained in the GLONASS. In GLONASS also, there is a standard precision service. So it also is available for the civilian purpose. And analogous to PPS, in case of GLONASS, they have high precision service, that is for the defense purposes. Whereas in case of Galileo, because Galileo is private, public-private partnership, PPP model is there in Galileo, it has a lot of commercial services along with the open services. So they are going to provide five kind of services in the times to come. the open source services will be there, then safety of life services will be there, then paid or commercial services will be there by Galileo Operating Consortium, then public regulated services will be there for European police and anti-fraud agencies, and then there is a fifth one, which is the search and rescue service to COSPAS and SARSAT system. So this is an international system wherein various space agencies cooperate with each other during the search and rescue operations. Wherever a problem is happening all over the globe, they all join hands to resolve those issues, like earthquake, flood, any such kind of thing which is happening. At that time, these treaties are utilized to get the data and save more and more people. Now, the current status of Navistar GPS is that we have Block 2R satellites, about 12 are operational. Then Block 2RM satellites, about 7 are operational. Block 2F, 12 are operational. And Block 3, as I discussed yesterday, is scheduled for launch in 2018. Block 2R, one more has completed life. So currently, now we have 11 operational. One more has completed its life. These statuses can be, they are in the open domain, and these can be checked by anyone on the net. So I have given the URL also from where we can check the current status. Similar to that, for this is for Navistar GPS. Additionally, we can see here that they have reserved the numbers. As I have discussed yesterday, there are two methods to address any satellite, a GPS satellite. One is the pseudo-random number given to it. Another is the satellite vehicle number. So like we can see here, block 1 has got satellite vehicle numbers from 1 to 11. Block 2 has numbers from 13 to 21 and so on. Similarly, we can see that block 3A has a reserved numbers from satellite vehicle number 74 to satellite vehicle number 81. So like that, these satellites are being prepared. And they are given names, either as satellite vehicle numbers or pseudo-random numbers. And these numbers are coming along with the coordinates, or that is the FMS data, when we are getting the broadcast FMS, broadcast signals from the GPS satellites in our GPS. Now, similar to Navistar GPS, we can get the information about the current status of GLONASS from this website, from the Russian website. Here also about 24 satellites are operational currently. And we can always see on these websites for Navistar GPS, GLONASS or Galileo that which are the satellites which are operational here, when they are completing their life, and when the spare satellites which are already existing, already placed in the orbits, will be switched on to give the services. That is the commissioning of the satellite. So all that information we can get from these three websites, respectively for Navistar GPS, for GLONASS or Galileo. So these are in an open environment and from various websites. So this is for the European GNSS Service Center for Galileo. Now, when we are using a GPS, then we are doing certain kind of processing for it. So normally our purpose is either to get a location of a point, such as in the application when we are looking for ground control points for triangulation or georeferencing of a remote sensing data set. So we can get a point calculated using a GPS as per the processing type, what we have discussed yesterday. We have kinematic processing, kinematic GPS survey, we have stop and go survey, we have rapid static and static service. These four yesterday we have covered. So by that we can get a point value or a line value, or we can get an area value. And these point, line and area can be imported into any GIS software for the purpose of mapping or any other applications, including modeling, because all these inputs can go into the GIS environment for any of the applications which we do. So we can prepare cadastral maps using the polygon option, or we can prepare road maps or path routes through using GPS and GIS. As yesterday I was discussing within the type of receivers, so we have single frequency receivers, dual frequency receivers primarily, and nowadays when we are going for GNSS receivers, we are having multi-frequency receivers, so wherein we are getting L1, L2 and other wavelengths also, more than 2 we are getting, so we are getting it multi, of course 2 is also multi only. So single frequency receivers, the recent receivers which have come up in the market, they are giving us an accuracy of the order of 5 millimeter plus 1 ppm. The GPS receivers before that, that means little old versions, they are capable of giving us 1 centimeter plus 2 ppm kind of accuracies. So a very high accuracy we are getting from single frequency receivers. Similarly, from the high end dual frequency receivers, we can get accuracy of the order of 3 millimeter in horizontal and 3.5 millimeter in vertical plus 0.4 ppm. That kind of high accuracies we are getting in horizontal and vertical from dual frequency receivers, whereas a little old version of dual frequency receivers which we have maybe 4-5 years back or like that, so they are able to give us an accuracy of 5 millimeter plus 1 ppm. So now the question is here that when we are going for single receiver, a single frequency receiver, we are as of now able to get 5 millimeter accuracy, and when we are going for dual frequency receiver, we are able to get 3 millimeter accuracy. For 2 millimeter we have to change the system. So is it worth? So that we have to judge on the requirement of the project itself. What is the application? That will decide that. It becomes important because the cost is having a lot of difference. When we are going for single frequency differential GPS receivers, we can get it in 4 to 5 lakh rupees. Whereas when we are going for dual frequency GNSS receivers, they are on higher sides. Of course, it depends upon the make what we are purchasing. But definitely dual frequency receiver, a set of 2 will cost around 15 to 30 lakhs, depending upon the vendor from where we are taking. How we are going to decide that whether we should work with the single frequency receiver or dual frequency receiver in case with 5 millimeter accuracy standard is permissible. So there is a parameter here which we have to check, and that is the baseline. If our study areas are small, wherein the baselines are of the order of 15 kilometer, in that particular case, for GPS survey, detailed GPS survey or network densification in aerial photography or satellite images, we can go for single frequency receivers. But if our baselines are longer than 15 kilometer, it is preferred to have dual frequency receivers or multi frequency receivers. So primarily, if we are dealing with large study areas, then we cannot go along with a single frequency receiver. There it is better that if we go with a dual frequency receiver. So when we are doing countrywide surveys or state wise or even district wise surveys, wherein a large regions are covered, it is preferable that we should go with minimum dual frequency receivers or multi frequency receivers for the GNSS surveys. So a large number of applications are being developed using these services. These unsophisticated receivers which can track L1, many of us are using in the form of the handheld GPS receivers, whereas some of us are using the high-end geodetic receivers also, in the Department of Space we are using, Survey of India we are using. Wherever large areas are under study or under mapping, there we take the control from the dual frequency receivers or multi-frequency receivers. So basic limitation in case of the single frequency receiver is primarily the baseline length. In dual frequency receivers, we can have literally a quite long baseline can be, or unlimited baseline length can also be in dual frequency receivers or multi frequency receivers, and we can have short occupation times, and we can have, if we have a RTK, if we have a arrangement for modem or any other means like a SIM card is attached, where the two receivers can talk to each other and transmit the corrections from the base to the rover receiver, then we can have real-time solutions also, and they can be updated on a server also depending upon the use of the technology. If we are using the latest communication techniques, we can get the updation in the maps while the team is working in the field. That kind of options are also there. And dual frequency receivers are there, so almost all kind of modes to do the survey: static, rapid, static, stop and go, and kinematic service, all we can do with the dual frequency receiver, whereas single frequency we can use wherever we have smaller study areas. We can use the single frequency receivers. What is real time actually? Real time is we want the coordinates corrected now or at this moment only for certain application, like we want to take off or land our aircraft. So then only there only at that moment we want the corrected coordinates. So for such applications which are having the requirement of real time, we are using RTK systems wherein the base and the rover stations can talk to each other and can send the corrections in the real time to the rover stations, so that these can be utilized for certain actions at that moment itself. So that is the real time processing. Other processing is the post processing. We survey, after the survey we download the data and we process the data. So that is the post processing mode, whereas in the real time mode we get the corrected value now and at the same moment there itself while we are surveying. So now we have different sources of errors. We have discussed a bit of it. We have seen the table yesterday. So there is a selective availability phenomena which has been switched off by US. It has been a phenomena wherein the US has been intentionally degrading the position of the what we are getting from the GPS. So it is an intentional degradation. It is called dithering also. So we give a error into the clock, which will result in an erroneous pseudo range. Pseudo range means, pseudo means false, and range means distance. So we have certain errors. So we refer to the distance between the satellite and the receiver as a pseudo range, because this pseudo range is, as we have seen, how we intersect three spheres when we receive three signals to get two solutions for position, whereas one is for the real and another is for the vague. So that we have seen yesterday. So this selective availability phenomena was disabled in May 2000, and currently it is not active. If this phenomena was active, then we were getting an error of about 10 to 30 or up to 100 meter error we were getting. So that was the kind of situation when selective availability was on. So anyway, so now the selective availability phenomena is off. So there are two phenomena which we talk in while discussing GPS. One is the SA, that is the selective availability, which I have just now told. And another is the AS. AS is anti-spoofing. So what is anti-spoofing? Anti-spoofing is the encryption of the P code. So that phenomena is known as anti-spoofing. So they add a W code to the P code, and that makes it the Y code. So it is not readable by us. So that there are two phenomena we can remember. One is SA, that is selective availability, and another is AS, that is the anti-spoofing. So this was the selective availability. And then we have clock errors which are emerging because of the use of the atomic clock on the satellite and quartz clock in the receiver. So we are using two clocks which are having different accuracy, different precision, which gives rise to a synchronization error between the two clocks. So that error is also required to be removed. Then ephemeris errors, they are the errors in the positioning of the satellite in their orbit. Currently, we are capable of calculating the position of satellites in their orbits to an accuracy of 1 to 3 meters, which is quite high. Then we have atmospheric delays in the ionospheric region and the tropospheric region. Then we have multipath errors and receiver errors, which we will discuss now. So this table I have shown you yesterday, wherein we have seen that using the differential GPS system, where we are using two systems together, the satellite clock errors can be corrected, the orbit errors can be corrected. So these form the part of the system errors, so which includes ephemeris data and satellite clock errors. Then we have atmospheric errors, which are ionospheric and tropospheric, which can be further reduced to 40 centimeter or 20 centimeter accordingly, as shown in the table, after the differential GPS processing. The receiver noise and multipath cannot be corrected like this, but using special antennas, we can reduce the multipath error. So one of the antenna which we use mostly at base station is known as choke ring antenna. So these antennas are used for the purpose of reducing the multipath error. So we are getting a dilution of precision. So we call the receiver noise and multipath error combined together as user equipment error. Whereas if the system errors and atmospheric errors fall under the user range error category. So we have a URE and UEE. So if we are getting a PDOP, positional dilution of precision value 2, which is shown in the handheld GPS receivers also, it is a dimensionless number, as we have discussed yesterday, that dilation of precision is something like similar to the root mean square error. But in the RMSE, in the statistics where we are using, we have units also. But this DOP has been simplified, and it is a unitless value, which is for a user to consider whether the values are very good, fairly good, or they are susceptible. So if it is more than 6, we do not rely on the values calculated by the GPS at that moment. So if the PDOP value is 2, we can assume that 1 meter URE, that is the user range error, will result in 2 meter of the positional error. So one is the when we are having ranging error, ranging we are doing between the satellite and the receiver. So that refers to the distance between the satellite and the receiver. That is the ranging error. Whereas positioning error means on the ground, our location. So if we have a 1 meter error in ranging, that is 1 meter error we are having in calculation of the radius of the sphere which we are making around the satellite to locate our receiver, then we can consider that it might introduce an error of 2 meter in the position. Okay, position in terms of the position of the point, because when we are ranging is in a line only, that the line which is joining the satellite with the receiver, whereas positioning is in the ECF coordinate system. That is the latitude, longitude and height. So in that we can have 2 meter error if we have a 1 meter error in the ranging. So selective availability we have already done. Then when there was a question yesterday on solar flare also. So there are charged particles in the ionosphere and there are free electrons also. So when the L1 and L2 wavelengths are passing through the ionosphere, there is a delay in the signal. So similar delay happens in the troposphere also. So the ionospheric errors and tropospheric errors are the part for the atmospheric delays. Now it is possible that if the baselines are small, as shown here, baselines are small, maybe of the order of 5 kilometers or 10 kilometers, then it is possible that the atmospheric conditions are same above in the ionosphere and the troposphere. But when we are having longer baseline, suppose we are running a nation across survey using GPS. We have a GPS station running at Jammu, and then we have a station running at Delhi, and then we have one station running at Hyderabad or Bangalore. We can process all the data sets together. That is the advantage while working with the GPS. But at that point of time, we have to take care of the atmospheric condition, because it may be a snowfall in Kashmir, and at the same time there may be rains in Uttarakhand, and then at the same time there may be sunny condition in other parts of the country. But at the, so there we cannot process this data from our regular softwares. Regular softwares go with the assumption of similar atmospheric conditions. So they do some atmospheric based on the some default values in the models. But so when we are having longer baselines, we have to process it differently with some scientific softwares like the Bernese and Gamut. There we can process the data, and we will have a special lecture on the advanced processing this time by Dr. Sri Suresh Kanojia in next week under the same module. So when we are working with the receivers with longer baselines, we have to use special softwares for that. Coming to the atmospheric reflection, so we have a sun's activity, and the sun activity like the solar flare, which we have discussed yesterday, it is going to affect the ionosphere very much, and that will control the delay in the atmosphere. It will control the ionospheric thickness and proportion concentration of ionized particles. All these parameters will affect the errors introduced in the ranging while the signals are being delayed while passing through the ionosphere. So these atmospheric reflection will depend upon sun activity, ionospheric thickness, proportions, season, and actual path which the signal has traveled. And these pseudo range errors can also vary from 0 to 15 meter at zenithal incidence to as much as 45 meter for low incidence angles. So that is why I have told you yesterday about the mask angle. So at the low incidence angles above the horizon, we usually exclude certain observations up to certain angle, and that angle we refer to as a mask angle. So we can keep the default value in handheld GPS receivers like the Juno from Trimble, it is 5 degrees. So otherwise in the high-end GPS receivers, there are options to set these, so we can go up to 10 degree or 15 degree as per the requirement, and the lower signals at lower incidence angles, those we can exclude. The delay is proportional to the integral number of free electrons, the total electron count. So tech is there. So the proportion, if the number of free electrons are more, the delay will be more. And it is inversely proportional to the square of the transmission frequency. That means if the frequency is lower, the delay will be more. If the frequency is higher, the delay will be less. So there are different models which are being used to calculate it, like 8-parameter model. And the delay on L1 is equal to 1.546 into difference in delay on L1 and L2. So that is why now this model we cannot use for the CA code, because CA code is available only on the L1. L2 we do not have that. But P code is available on L1 as well as L2. So we know that the receivers which are having access to the P code, they will get the value of this delay, delay in difference of L1 and L2. We can also do it, but we can do it only in while having phase solution, not code solution, because code is not accessible, but the phase will be available to us on L1 and L2 both. So as a note is given here, if we have a same code on two frequencies, then we can apply this formula to resolve the delay, calculate the delay in the signal, whereby we can give corrections for the ionospheric delays. So that is the way to reduce the errors because of ionosphere. Similarly, coming to the tropospheric reflection, the troposphere is the lowest layer of atmosphere varying from 7 to 14 kilometers. So this also varies from the equator region to the polar regions, and accordingly the tropospheric errors will also vary from equator to the tropospheric region. In case of pseudo range errors due to the tropospheric refraction, again we can see that it can be from 2 meter to 30 meter. If the 2 meter if the satellite is near zenith, that is just above us, just above the receiver, then we can have low amount of errors, something like 2 meters. But if it is about the horizon, okay, so we can have an error of the order of 30 meters also. So again here this angle is important, so that is the mask angle. So what we can do again while processing, we can exclude the values which we are receiving from the lower angles, because currently what is happening, we are getting a large number of satellites while working anywhere, because we are working with multiple systems, that is system of systems or constellation of constellations, that is the GNSS. So we are having no shortage of signals currently. So we can choose in the while processing the signals which we feel are suitable for us, and we can exclude the others. So it is better to exclude the signals normally up to 10 degrees nowadays, because we have 15, 16 satellites at any moment easily available to us. 15, 16 satellites can give us, that means around 30 signals, because there is a L1 frequency and L2 frequency. So we are getting multiple frequency from each satellite. So multiplied by the number of satellites, we can get a large number of signals. So there is no paucity of signals now. So we should give certain value to the mask angle and see the change in the result. So our errors will reduced by giving a mask angle something like 5 degree to 10 degree. So that we can do. The delay in the tropospheric region depends upon the temperature, pressure, humidity and elevation of the satellite. So as I was telling, if the baselines are small, the softwares like Ski Pro from Leica, or Leica Geo Office from Leica, or Trimble Business Center, so they are using Sastamonian or Hopfield models with some certain default parameters. So this can do the corrections for atmospheric errors. But if we are going for longer baselines, then we have to use Bernese or Gamut softwares, which are the scientific software. So this slide shows the multipath errors. So in case of multipath errors, what happens that the instead of So usually we are looking for the signal which comes from the satellite to the receiver directly, as shown here. But along with that, certain signals are hitting the ground and going to the receiver, or they are hitting the adjoining building and again, sorry, going to the receiver. So the signals which are not going directly to the receiver and they are reaching the receiver after hitting certain other object, they introduce error. And these error is referred as multipath error. So for that, we have a special design of antenna, like the choke ring antenna. This is a quite heavy antenna, around 5 kg antenna, and usually on the base stations we use it. We have a lighter designs from Trimble also, like the Geofire antenna, that is a lighter one, that also has a technique to reduce the multipath errors. Additionally, we have a plate at the bottom also, which is called ground plane, to avoid the signals coming from the ground also. So we have this kind of precautions in the hardware also to avoid multipath errors getting into our system. Now, as I was discussing, sometimes there is an obstruction to the signals also. If we are going in a hilly region, so we may be getting signals from one side only, and from other side we may not get. So earlier we used to have a lot of problems because of this. But currently, because the number of satellites, number of constellations have increased, for over Dehradun, I can tell you at any point of time, we are getting 8 to 10 satellites from BDO also nowadays. And we are getting around 9, 10 GPS satellites. We are getting around 7 to 8 Galileo satellites also at times. Then we have IRNSS receivers, IRNSS satellites above us. So we are getting a large number of satellites now. So even if we have a blockage from one side, still on the other side, we get a large number of satellites. Our requirement is 4 only, but still we are getting 10, 12. There is no problem with that. Only problem is that because the signals are coming from one side only. So as I have told you the thumb rule yesterday, lower the volume, lower is the accuracy, higher the volume, higher is the accuracy. So what happens when there is a skewed configuration, as in the case of obstructions, when we are passing through the valleys and we have hills all around, what happens, the DOP value, dilational precision, is poor. So our accuracy reduces. Although we are getting the solution, we get a position, but our accuracy reduces. This is the problem when we have obstructions. Similarly, when we are doing surveys, particularly the static surveys for ground control point measurement, we should establish our station at a location which is relatively in an open area, and we should not have electrical lines or buildings nearby so that they hit, create multipass or some other kind of interference in our signals, because that can introduce errors in the final solution. Another error is the human error. So human error is the most simple thing which we can avoid if we are working carefully. We can avoid the human error. Another thing with the human error is it is difficult to estimate, because it depends what kind of mistake the operator is doing. So it can range from anywhere to anywhere. So it can introduce small errors to large errors or blunders if we are doing so. So there should be a proper standard operating procedures so that the operator is aware about them with the due training, and operate the GPS equipment correctly so as to take various measurements, as shown in this picture where he is taking a slant height measurement for the GPS receiver. So human errors are like that. We are difficult to estimate, but easy to avoid if we are using a proper standard operating procedures. So now the final question is that using a single receiver, we are getting accuracy of the order of 10 to 20 meters. Our applications require more accuracy. So how to improve the positional accuracy? So the answer to that is, let us use the differential GPS method or the relative GPS method. They are same. Relative GPS is a less used term. Differential GPS is a very common term which we are using. This can improve our receiver position, satellite positions, and ionospheric errors can be corrected, and carrier phase measurements can be done to finally give an accuracy of millimeter to centimeter level. So we can use DGPS here. What we are doing primarily is like that. We have one base station here, and we have a modem on that for real time applications. If we are not using modem, then we can do the post processing after downloading the data. But if we have modem, they can communicate between them, and the errors from the base stations, because errors are calculated at the base station, because the base station is a known station, the locations are known there. So the errors can be communicated to the rover station. So primarily what happens here is that we know the location of the base station. So we know the XYZ coordinates. Now when the signals are coming from the satellites to the base and the rover, we know the position of the base, and then we get the current location of the base through the broadcast ephemeris. So that is, current is the X dash, Y dash, Z dash. The known value is X, Y, Z. So we can calculate the error at the base, that is epsilon X is equal to X minus X dash, epsilon Y is equal to Y minus Y dash, and epsilon Z is equal to Z minus Z dash. Now these errors can be used for correction on the rover station. So that is how we are correcting it. So we can calculate the amount of error which is there in the timing by calculation of X minus X dash, Y minus Y dash, Z minus Z dash. Usually what we are doing, we are multiplying the delta T into C to get the position. Whereas here, because the position is known, we can calculate the error in position or in ranging, and that can be translated into the error in timing also. So that is how the differential GPS processing works, and it eliminates the satellite and receiver clocks errors. So we can almost eliminate, we get zero error in satellite and receiver clocks. It minimizes atmospheric delays, so we can have improvement in the ionospheric error. From meters level, we can go to the centimeter level of error. So there is a large improvement in that using the phase method. Then accuracy can be improved from 0.5 centimeter to 5 meter. So when we are using cold solutions, we can get an accuracy of the order of sub-meter nowadays. Previously, we were calling it a 5 meter accuracy level, but currently we can get better, about 50 centimeter accuracy also we are getting through differential GPS processing using code solution. Whereas through phase or code or phase and code together, we can get an accuracy of the order of millimeters. So that is how there are multiple ways of processing, either based on code or phase or based on phase and code both. So we can get a high order of accuracy. So this is the DGPS method which I have just explained. It is a method to remove errors from the GPS measurements. It uses a GPS receiver at a fixed surveyed location. That is the base stations whose X, Y, Z coordinates are known. And using this, we calculate the errors in the pseudo range. That is the X minus X dash, Y minus Y dash, and Z minus Z dash. Base station receives the same GPS signal as the roving receiver. As I explained yesterday, we are getting large number of signals on the base and on the rover also. It is required that four common signals should be there between them. Then only we can resolve. So that is this third step. And here, instead of using timing signal to calculate its position, it uses its known position to calculate timing. So it is here we are doing it the other way. We already know the position and we know the current position. So we can calculate the error. And accordingly, we can calculate the error in the timing. So pseudo range error for each satellite is subtracted from rover before calculating position from RTK mode or post processing. So these error which we are calculating at the base station, these errors can be applied for correction at the rover station. So rover stations are at the unknown locations, and this can be done in two ways again, either in the post processing mode, that means we do the survey, later on we come to the office or our station and download the data and process the data, or if we have a modem on the systems, the errors can be communicated from the base to the rover live, that is in the real time. So we can have a correction at the time of using GPS itself. Now the signal time at reference location is compared to the time at the remote location. Time difference represents in the error in the satellite's signal, that is the clock bias. So that is how here we are using ranging differences to calculate the differences in the timing. So we should understand this process. For DGPS survey, we require minimum four satellites common. If we have a data link through modem, we can get real-time processing, or we can have post-processing to achieve high accuracy. Because nowadays we require high accuracy for our various applications. This is the post-processing mode where we do not have a modem installed on the systems. So there we have to do the survey, come to the place of work, download the data and process it. So we can do the post-processing. So this is how we can do the post-processing. So two methods, real-time RTK, that is RTK survey, or post-processing method. For the RTK purpose, standard output RTCM104 is being used. It is a binary code and it is not directly readable. Receivers often provide RTCM104 on a RS232 serial port. So these are some specifications which are being used. So we have antenna or a modem to transmit the signal to the rover station, which is shown here in the form of a person who is installing and placing the GPS, the rover station, on the field. So that gives the real-time solution. Now, I would like to explain that how we are doing it. Now, when we are going to the field and we have an image for which we want the control points at location R1, at location R2, at location R1/3, at location R2/3. So, what is the process that I would like to explain here? So, what we do, we consider that we have three systems to use at a time. So, we will install one station at the base station, which will function for the entire duration of survey. Then one of our team will go to the R1 location, establish the GPS there. Another team will go to the R2 location and establish the GPS there. Now R1 and R2 are operating together along with the base station. So what will happen that we have common observations between R1, R2 and base station. So it forms a triangle. We can do it with two also, R1 and base, but what will happen in that case, triangle is not formed. So we have radial solutions only. So our error distribution will not be so good. But when we are using three systems together, it gives us triangle and we can apply a least square adjustment for the error distance in the triangle. So that gives us the best accuracy. And all the highest accuracies which we have been discussing, 5 millimeter, 3 millimeter, all these consider or assume that we are working with minimum three systems. If we are working with two systems, that those kind of accuracies will be difficult to achieve, although with some hardship it may be possible with long-term observations. But usually we are supposed to work with three systems in an ideal condition. So when we have enough observation between R1, R2 and base, depending upon the baseline length, suppose our baseline length is 10 kilometer, then we may observe for 30 minutes or 40 minutes. If our baseline lengths are of the order of 20 kilometer or more, we can go for observation of 1 hour plus for the rover stations, because base station is always working, so there is no question of timing at base. It has been always working. That is the assumption when we are surveying. We can keep it on for 24 hours for all the days we are working for the control point surveys. We can give a direct power to it so that there is no charging problem with the base. But for rover stations, we are working for 40 minutes, 1 hour, or 1.5 hour, up to 72 hours, depending upon the kind of survey we are opting. So once we complete the survey for R1, R2 and base, then the R1 station will be made free. It will be switched off and then it will be taken to the third point, because we have to use the error adjustment theory. So what will happen now, this is referred as R1/3, because from one station we have come to the third station. Now R2 and R1/3 will work together along with the base and will have again necessary amount of observation. So this was our first triangular solution and this constitute our second. So now we will have minimum 1 hour or so common between the observations of base R2 and R1/3. Once that is over, then we can release R2, and R2 we will bring to the next point. So now we will get third triangle. Okay, and so on we will continue. So that is the way to the differential GPS survey and cover the whole day. Here we have to remember, because we are not completing the survey in one day itself, that the last point for a day becomes the first point for the next day. So that is how we close the circle as per the principle of surveying. So on the f on the last point of every day will be reoccupied on the next day, and that will be the first point for the next day, and we will continue the survey for the rest of the points. So post-processing is simple. We have to simply download the rover data and the base data, and then through the software we can do the corrections and remove the errors except the multipath. For the multipath, what we are doing, we are using appropriate antennas. So like for Trimble Geofire antenna is there, that can that has the capability to reduce multipath, or from Leica we can have a Chokring antenna that can also reduce multipath errors, because these errors cannot be corrected by the DGPS service. So better to use a appropriate antenna for reducing the multipath, because they have a special design to reduce it. So when we use the differential GPS survey, we are able to partially correct most of the atmospheric errors. So we are able to correct ionospheric errors and tropospheric error, reduce them to a larger extent. Clock errors and ephemeris errors we can totally nullify. Multipath errors we cannot correct from GPS differential survey and differential GPS survey, and similarly receiver noise also we are not able to correct. So finally, the larger errors which are given by atmospheric errors and clock and ephemeris data, they are corrected. Multipath error we are correcting using the appropriate receiver, but the receiver noise still remains of the order of 30 centimeter or so. So this GPS surveying techniques we have discussed yesterday. So again, to recall here again that if we have longer baselines, we can use static surveys. If we have smaller baselines, we can use rapid static survey. We can use handheld GPS itself. We need not to go for geodetic receivers for simpler surveys where we require low accuracies and we can conduct a stop and go survey. But for kinematic survey, we can again use geodetic receivers where we want some trajectory, like trajectory of the flight path of an aircraft or a missile path or a path which has been tracked by a taxi. So for all that we can use. Again, I would like to tell GPS, if you want to track, we need to have a tracking device in case of the taxis. As such, this is a one-way ranging system. We cannot track our GPS directly. We need to have a tracker for that. These are the pictures shown for various kind of GPS receivers available in the market. So this particular picture, if you are able to see, this is a Chokring antenna and there is a transparent plastic covering or glass covering over it. It is called radome. It is for particular for the protection. So if you are installing the receiver in a snow fall or some area where we have a snowfall or rainfall, so we can keep these cappings over them so that our equipment is safe. So this is called radome. So radomes can be used to protect our equipment. And these are some other models which we can see on the slide. So we have we also have a radome here, you can see. So at IARS, we have installed a continuously operating reference station which works 24 hours, 365 days. And this we utilize for our calculation of tectonic movements here. Whenever some movements are happening, we are calculating at IARS. Sri Suresh will further put a light on that. We have established similar stations at Gopeshwar, GB Pant University, and our NRC counterparts which are working for this project. They have put at Manali, Bhuj area, two receivers they have put in Bhuj. A large number of receivers has been put across India like this from various institutes like NGRI, Wadia Institute of Himalayan Geology. So we are working together also, IARS and these agencies are working together and calculating the movements which are taking place in the earth crust, how these movements are taking place during the natural with the progression of time as well as during the earthquakes also. So this will be further taken delved in a separate session. And this is the location which is marked here in the IRS campus where we have installed this CORS station. So we can, this is a net R9 receiver from Trimble. So we can see here we have from Navistar the snapshot when it was taken. We have 11 satellites from Navistar GPS, 6 satellites from GLONASS, 1 from Galileo at that moment, and 6 from BDO. But we get up to 10 satellites from BDO also at times. So a large number of satellites are visible nowadays, and the data can be very safely and easily processed with a high accuracy. So advantage of differential GPS is finally that we can get a very high accuracy of the order of centimeters and millimeters, which can be used for urban mapping, road alignment, railway alignment, canal alignment, and for various mapping exercises to prepare map for various cartographic purposes, water resource purposes. So we are able to use differential GPS surveys, the positioning data which we have got from it with a high accuracy in planimetry as well as vertical height. So we are using it because vertical height becomes very important for certain applications like water resources applications, where the because water flows with the head, so from the higher head it will go to the lower head, so height is very important for that. So for all those such applications we are using a differential GPS survey. Now with the as the technology is developing, we are getting smarter and smarter tools. Our engineers are having a survey of India topo sheet with them, wherein we are having Everest ellipsoid and mean sea level heights with the older sheets. With the new, of course, they are providing with UTM, and the open series maps are also available, where we have UTM's values also. But sometime our engineers face problem that on the one hand they have topo sheet in one hand and another hand they have the GPS, and the values do not match, so they are referring to different datums. So one is the WGS 84 datum, another is the mean sea level datum. So how to resolve? So for this we have a very good solution called Smart Station from Leica, and similar solutions are from other vendors also. So we have a Smart Stations which has a total station combined with a GPS. So we have on the same mount we have a total station also, and we have a GPS also. So at the same time, while working in the field, we will get the mean sea level height also, and we will get the GPS height also, and that will resolve our problem to a larger extent, and we can know about the geoid undulation also. So this is a very good equipment. Along with that, we have some PDA type of equipments also, lighter ones. The mapping solutions are there, like Juno model is there, or Xeno model from Leica. Juno is from Trimble. So Mayo is from another company. So they also give mobile solutions where we have a GPS along with a mobile facility. We can put a SIM card into it. There is a camera in that, and there is a GPS software also. So we have a lot of handy solutions. Of course, these are having little less accuracy, whereas the geodetic receivers give us large accuracy. So this is another solution from Compaq. We have an ArcPad software in it, in this. So we have a GPS unit handled PC with a good amount of storage. Nowadays we get up to GB's amount of storage also, which can host a vector as well as raster data, and it can be used in the field for applications like cadastral mapping very safely, with options to use SIM card and update the maps in real time on the servers. So there, those kind of applications have developed. This is one example. We have different kind of models from various vendors. So this specifically shows for the Trimble, which gives us different kind of accuracy ranging from 2 to 5 meters to sub-foot accuracy. But the sub-foot accuracies are after processing. Standalone, it is difficult to get such accuracies without processing. So multipath rejection technology is there in some of the models. Some other models do not have that kind of antenna. So there the accuracies are on the lower side. But to caution, whenever we are using single frequency receivers, handled receivers, let us in general take that the accuracies will be of the order of 10 to 20 meters. Because higher accuracies can only be received when DOP values are very high, very good. DOP values are under control, and they are very much reliable. So they are lower actually. So 1 to 3 kind of DOP values are there, then we can get high accuracies. So as I have told, in general we are getting along with the GPS some commercial softwares like SQ Pro, like a GeoOffice, GPS Survey or Trimble Business Center or GPSS Spectrum Survey from various vendors. This can be used for smaller baselines, maybe for little longer ones also. But when we are going for a nationwide surveys, larger baselines are there, 200 kilometer, 500 kilometer or 1000 or 2000 kilometer also, and even longer also. Then we need to utilize softwares like Barneys, Gamut or Gypsy or Dipup or GeoNap, which are scientific softwares wherein you can play with the softwares. You can have certain atmospheric parameters input for them also, such as correction through the ionospheric files for doing correction in the ionospheric region. So ionospheric errors can be reduced, tropospheric errors can be reduced. So those kind of things are difficult to do in the commercial softwares, which usually work with the default values. But in the scientific software, those parameters can be input for in temperature, humidity, pressure to do the corrections. So scientific softwares will be required there. So we will have a special session on this in one of the other lectures by Ashutosh. So thank you very much.